We have a members' meeting. This is going to be immediately following the second service on March 13th. That's going to be at 1 o'clock p.m. The outreach team is still collecting men's pants for the mission to distribute in the month of March. And if you have anything to print, you can go ahead and put it in the drop box over in the lobby. And finally, we still have Harvest America, believe it or not, is next Sunday. I want to make sure because somebody said expressed surprise when I said next Sunday. So, right in the sanctuary.
What?
Right in the sanctuary. We have a big screen up here, and there's going to be all sorts of things, including snacks. Now, if you're interested in bringing snacks, we have sign up sheets in the back there that are going to be passed around during during our offerings. You can sign up to bring something. And we're going to be having, what is it? Some worship at 5:30. It starts at 6, so make sure you get here a little bit early. And that's it. Let's do some more worship.
Thank you.
called to us this week that's drawn our eyes away from you, Father, we just strip away. If it's fear, if it's hurt, if it's relationship issues, financial issues, health issues, Father, I just pray that you would just take all of that and leave it outside these doors, Father, as we bring this sacrifice of praise to you.
You are love. moment, you know, the morning where everything was bad and everybody hated each other. You come to church and, okay, here we are. So we've all had those kind of mornings. But God just reminded me of who he used in the Bible, that they were pretty messed up people, just like us. If you think about David, when he was a little boy, a lot of us have heard the story about how he, you know, killed Goliath with a stone. And then when he grew up, he did some pretty stupid stuff, some pretty major stupid stuff, like adultery and murder, like really bad stuff. But he had a heart after God, and he was okay. He made mistakes, but he had a heart after God. He wasn't perfect, but God used him. And then I think about Peter, and Peter's awesome because Peter just screwed up all the time, but he did really cool stuff. Like, he's the one that stepped out on the boat, on the water, that nobody else did, and then he fell down. And he's the one at the very end, three times, somebody came up to him and said, "Do you know Jesus?" And he said, "No, I don't know Jesus." You know, if we met somebody like that and we just talked about, what a horrible guy, you know, how dare he do that? But he did it three times, and he was with him. But then he's the one that Jesus said, "I'm going to build the church on you." He changed his name to Rock. So he took all of his wavering ways and flakiness and weakness, and he changed it. And he changed his name to Rock. So I just want to encourage you. Maybe you're like David. Maybe when you were younger, either spiritually or like your real age, you were really following the Lord. And maybe right now you're not. But your heart's still there. God knows that. And it's not too late to come back around. And maybe you're walking on the water right now. And that's awesome, like Peter. Maybe you just fell in. I feel like I just fell in. Maybe somebody asked you at work, "Are you a Christian?" You said no. Or you're not acting like you are. But that's okay. Because God can change you. So, like this morning we sang, "In your freedom I will live." I was kind of thinking, I don't feel really free right now. But that's not our job to do that. That's God's job to do that. So if we declare and we accept his freedom, he gives that to us. But we have to go get it. We have to accept it. So wherever you are, I would just encourage you, don't let your own feelings of failure or worthlessness or whatever keep you from God. We all sin. We all make mistakes, but what we do with it is what really matters. And that's often how we get stronger. So I would just encourage you, for the last few songs of worship, whatever the day was like, whatever the morning was like, however small you feel, just put that all aside, because God wants to meet you.
You will be with me. I believe in you. You're the God of miracles. that?
Yes.
That we serve a God of miracles?
Yes.
He performs miracles among us, and sometimes we fail to see those miracles. Sometimes they're right in front of us, and we recognize them. But in no matter whether we see them or whether we don't see them, God does miracles all the time. Kelly was talking about David. David saw this man who was trying to attack his people, and he knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that his God was there with him if he went after that man who was trying to hurt his people. He knew it because God had done a miracle in his life, a couple of them as a matter of fact. He was able to protect the flock from a bear and a lion, I believe it was, or a bear and a lion. And he was able to do that barehandedly because God was with him. So he knew that God was with him. And that's the key. We have to believe that God is with him. We have with us. We have to believe that he is a God of miracles and he will do miracles. And if we stay with him, if we believe in him, if we trust him, if we obey him, if we do everything we know in our power to come alongside of him, he will do miracles. Amen?
Amen.
You have to believe that.
That's right.
If we fall short of believing that, the miracle may not be seen. Doesn't mean it didn't happen. Hallelujah. So trust in God with everything in your heart. David, although he was being persecuted by the people around him, even the people he was trying to protect, and was telling him, you can't defeat this giant. He is a warrior. He is one who is a professional killer. You can't do it. David said, I know I can't, but my God can.
Right.
He can do it. And so he went into prayer. He went with full-hearted prayer, and knowing God was with him, said, I'll do it. Stood before David and defeated him. We have a God who will do miracles for us.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
I feel like God's telling me to share. We're singing a God of miracles, but it's so easy, like Bob was saying, to just kind of sing the words and not think about it. But if you think there's so many miracles in all of our lives that we just chalk up to science, or we chalk up to put a different word to it, but the fact that a little seed can fall and grow a big plant, that's a miracle. You know, the fact that us women can grow a baby in our belly and just birth, that's a miracle. And God just, I was thinking that, got kind of convicted my own heart, because I've had miracles. I've had ones that aren't just the mundane every day. And God just told me I needed to share this with you guys, because I had kind of forgotten. My youngest son, Brandon, is 22 now. When he was a year and a half, we found out that he had something called chronic ITP, which was where his body, it was an autoimmune disorder, his body was destroying his own platelets, and those are the clotting agents in blood. He was having major bleeds, just diapers full of nothing but blood. And as a mom, as a dad, the fear that, I mean, we just be in Sizzler and all of a sudden we'd have to rush to the hospital. And this was happening over and over. And he had something inside of him that was causing his intestines to bleed. But because he had no clotting agents, it didn't stop. They would just keep going. And we found out that him and one other boy in the whole state of California were the only two that had it. And the other boy passed away. So it became very real to us that this was not just a normal thing. We even had to wear a helmet because even picking my son up would put bruises on his skin. If he was to bump his head, they said he could bleed out and die. So we had him wearing the sparring helmet running around because it was better than losing my son. We were at a friend's house and they had wooden stairs that went up to a hallway, and on one side of the hallway was just all their rooms, and it was almost like a hotel type thing, but that's how their house was, and these were hardwood stairs. And I always had a little bit of a fear going over there because I'm like, what if I trip and fall with him going down the stairs, or what if he falls? And so we always kept the door shut. We'd go in the living room, we'd shut the door, that way he couldn't go out. And
one day we, oh, we were getting ready to leave, and I was calling him to put that helmet on. And we opened that door, and the hallway's dark, and he just darted right into the darkness. I could hear him going down those stairs. I could hear, it was just like, it sounded like a herd of buffalo just stomping down those stairs. I don't even remember getting to the door. I just remember being out of the dark in that darkness and feeling for the light. I couldn't hear my son. All I could hear was this huge thumping. We turned on the light, and he was facing this way with his arms up towards me, and he was kind of going down belly-wise. I couldn't get to him fast enough, but I got to him, and I just rushed him upstairs and into the bathroom because I need to look him over. He didn't have one bruise. He didn't even have the marks that we got from picking him up. There was nothing on him. This boy didn't have his sparring helmet on. He had nothing. Nothing. Not a bruise. And that was a miracle because I could have lost him right then. And God had a plan. I wasn't part of the plan. I took him to the doctor anyway, to make sure there wasn't anything internal going on. Even the doctor said this is a miracle. And after that, my son always said Gyangia. We didn't know what Gyangia was until he saw a manger and he took the little angel off and he carried it around and called it Gyangia. So I don't know, he was too little to remember what he saw or what his experience was, but I know that God had him, whether it was through angels or whatever, he protected him and held him the whole way down the stairs. How I can forget something like that, even though it's been 20 years. It's not the forefront of my brain, I think it should be, because it reminds me of how wonderful God is. And he performs miracles every day, and we should never, ever take that for granted and think that something's too big for God.
God's got it going on in our everyday life. This young man right here is absolute evidence of that, and I think he knows that. Riding his bike hit by an SUV at 55 miles an hour, and virtually nothing. In our day-to-day lives, I think it's happening a lot more than we like to give it credit for, and God is just amazing. I go along with what Kelly was saying earlier. I think Peter must have been a drummer. Father God, Lord, I just thank you and I praise you for loving us even sometimes when we get distracted and we don't let you be our focus. Now we're going to enter into the next form of worship with giving back just a piece of what you've given us and blessed us with. Part that we can just use to reach out to our community, and that this church can have everything that it needs to be the blessing to beyond these four walls that it needs to be, that our needs will be met, taken care of. I offer up this offering. You ask us to give with a cheerful heart, knowing that our gifts are poured right to your throne. So in Jesus' name, I pray. Bless us all. Jesus.
special treat.